consulted later on afterwards. I just want to give an introduction here for this actually two-day session. We have first day is today about the concept of virtual mobility in general. And tomorrow it's more specifically on open virtual mobility as a multiplier event from the project OpenVM. Why did we organize this today? It's mostly about virtual mobility being an emerging topic for most universities and especially the university alliances, as this is an activity of the European University Alliances. And we have seen several developments going on in virtual mobility over the past years that we would like to introduce you how we map these and categorize these. And I will do that in my first presentation on the educational framework for virtual mobility. And then we have several good practices to show you by speakers who are representing these good practices under the categories that we have identified by our task force virtual mobility. You can have questions, one or two questions we will take after each presentation, but we will have room for further discussion at 12, in which we look back at the questions that have not been answered at that point. Please use below in the right corner of your screen, you see a text balloon, which is to write messages, and a question mark to write your questions. And it's important to distinguish both, because in the end, we are only looking at the question mark to find your questions. I hope it's all clear, and I'm really glad you all signed up. And let me start with the presentation of the educational framework for virtual mobility. I can find it here. Yes. Yeah. Okay. So yeah. Let me start with an explaining educational framework by introducing to you two publications by EADTU quite recently. It's on the right about the EADTU mobility matrix, making distinction between distance education, virtual mobility, and physical mobility. And on the left, the task force result models, innovative models for organizing mobility. We have started this last year with our task force from EADTU, but this is the result of that. Actually, we have started on virtual mobility more than 10 years ago. And the problem only then was that virtual mobility was not on the political agenda so high, and it was really misunderstood as being a format, as a second best solution for physical mobility. For those who can't be physical mobile, we then have a second best solution, a virtual mobility. As we have always promoted, that this is really something different. It has an added value, its own schemes, its own formats. So I will explain that today in this presentation and by showing the good practices. So we're happy that finally it has become a full operational program, virtual mobility next to physical mobility. And as there are more and more initiatives arising in the past years, we felt the need to start mapping these and also categorizing these, because the terminology was also used differently and very confusing. Some called it virtual exchange, some virtual mobility, some confused distance education with virtual mobility. And so that was already a need we felt to explain this further by these two publications. To start with the task force that did all the work in preparing this educational framework, it is EADTU being the chair, coordinator of this task force, and then we had several universities there that are representing different virtual mobility examples. And so every participant showed an example, and that was helping to start mapping what was going on, going deeper into the details of every example. But we also used examples from outside the task force, of course. The task of the task force was threesome. First of all, bringing together good practices within and outside EADTU membership on virtual mobility, about making inventory of new developments in the field of virtual mobility, and explaining how virtual mobility can stimulate European university networks. So this was, in our terms of reference of the task force, our main goal. always after we have explored new topics, innovative topics, we have a first conceptualization, first mapping, and then we bring it to a broader audience of stakeholders. And also we did that with virtual mobility within a peer learning activity, where we invited also universities from out the task force and other stakeholders like university networks, Cranbrook, Chiron, student representatives, public authorities, and also the agencies, ARCA, DRD. I remember DICU from Norway was there, and also NETHER. So, and then we get a good reflection on our first results. We fine tune them further and also come together with these stakeholders to recommendations that I will demonstrate to you later on. And looking where mobility, where virtual mobility was actually introduced in the developments over the years in mobility. Here you have the full overview, starting with classic mobility, the physical Erasmus program, then there were network programs with mobility windows, later on the joint degrees. But really, the introduction of virtual mobility only started with the strategic partnerships, the knowledge alliances, and the capacity building, and now much more prominently within the European University Alliances, where virtual mobility is really an important element and an integral part of the alliances. What we try to achieve with virtual mobility is that we want to create proximity and involvement of potentially all students by using new media, social software, to bring them online together. It is about increasing accessibility for students, create interactivity, use flexibility, because we're also addressing a group of continuing education who have obligations and whereby it's not possible to be physically mobile as well. We have formats of synchronous, asynchronous solutions and multi-campus education. This is all part, these are all elements of virtual mobility. But already in the definition of virtual mobility, for which I come next to a full definition, we always had the confusion between virtual mobility and distance education. If a student from the Dutch, if a Dutch student is taking a course from UNED, for example, in Spain, this is not virtual mobility. Often people see this as an online course being virtually mobile to Spain, but this is actually distance education. This is a student-university relation. It's a contract by a student with a university and a learning agreement between a student and a university. This is distance education. When we're talking about virtual mobility, it is a concept of bilateral and multilateral agreements between universities. The university is the initiator here in organizing a fully facilitated mobility scheme between bilateral and multilateral set of universities. That means that the universities already look at the coherence of the offerings between the different universities. They check the quality of the offerings, and also the recognition of the ECTS gained by the student. In fact, the student will have, is not pioneering, the student has is taking a course from another university abroad as if it is from its own university. It is also part of its own student guide of the university. It's only enriching the offerings of your own university with offerings from other universities. So that's the distinction between virtual mobility and distance education. Looking at what is part of organizing these bilateral, multilateral mobility schemes between universities, you are coming across a lot of points of discussion for organizing this collaboration. We met this in our project network curricula in NETCU. This is very much needed within virtual mobility schemes as well. We have to talk about the design of the contents, the co-production, sometimes management aspects, the platforms you're using, language. But this is the full list based on some 20 examples of network curricula that we use. So also very relevant for organizing virtual mobility schemes. The full definition of virtual mobility by the European Commission is this one: a set of activities supported by information communication technologies, including e-learning, that realize or facilitate international collaborative experiences in the context of teaching, training, and learning. So this is a very general definition, for which we certainly would like to add that that it has to be that we are talking about formal courses or curricula, it has to be bilaterally organized between universities, universities taking the initiative, like I just explained, and guaranteeing the rights of the students. So we like to add this to the definition of the European Commission. But the core goal is organizing international academic experience for students. Looking at the basic principles of organizing virtual mobility, it's similar to education. It can be organized face-to-face, online, or in a blended mode. So it can be done with mobility. And then you have, in developing a program or curriculum, you can look into and play with the elements of short-term, long-term, intermittent visits, synchronous, asynchronous, and multi-campus visits. Reflecting this on the mobility schemes, we see here three ways of organizing mobility. First of all, you're talking about physical mobility with physical mobility with actual immersion, which is typical for physical mobility. We can talk about online virtual mobility, as discussed just now, or a blended form in which we combine physical and online mobility, which can often strengthen each other in combination. So these are the three types of mobility. Then, I think it's a good one. Looking at them, at their specifics, their characteristics of these three types of mobility, you see that physical mobility can be organized short-term, long-term, as blended, and online mobility can also be intermittent. Intermittent means that you can start online international experience, stop it for a while, start it again. This can be helpful in the process of learning. Short-term also means for physical mobility that we are talking about 3 months, at least 3 months experience. As with blended and online mobility, it can be shorter, of course. Typical for physical mobility is also that you visit one campus for 3 months or longer. As with online mobility, you can visit multi-campuses. You can combine offerings from different universities in building your program. So this is quite different. We looked further into the formats to categorize the current offerings in virtual mobility, to categorize them to four types of formats. Here you have, first of all, embedded mobility within a course. So that means that the course is enriched by short visits to another offering of another university, to find elements to enrich your course. Then, secondly, we are talking about virtual mobility as exchange mobility for individual students. That means the classical physical mobility, but then in an online form. The student is taking part in a facilitated mobility scheme between universities and finding a course somewhere else. Thirdly, we're talking about network mobility and network curricula, in which we have a mobility window. So universities together develop a program where optionally students can find a course at another university. Within the fourth format, this is actually mandatory. So in a joint curricula, you have a mandatory set of courses to visit different universities, find the courses there, and finish your program. So these are the four formats. Also, these we have here categorized by, lined up by characteristics. I will not go into further detail in this, but typically for exchange mobility is that the courses are taken as they are. While with mobility within a course, you can negotiate, work together with other universities and what offerings they can provide to enrich your course. For joint programs, of course, these are really co-owned and co-organized programs. So we have taken these four categorizations to map good practices in virtual mobility currently in Europe. This is not the full list, even we have even more examples. And as you have seen in the program, we will show some of these examples after this introductory presentation. One of them is not represented in the presentation later on, but which is really interesting is the European Virtual Seminar. It's interesting because it is organized already for more than 15 years. That means that virtual mobility is not something like a pilot. It's really can be organized as mainstream offering to your students. The European Virtual Seminar is about sustainability, and the Open University of the Netherlands coordinating that with 10 to 15 universities every year. Interesting here is that they prevent difficulties in administrative issues by having students visiting different universities, preventing the enrollment. So the student does not fully enroll to another university. There is a kind of a cloud above the 10 to 15 universities which are part of this European Virtual Seminar, in which they share material, in which they share the teaching and the assessments in this let's say, cloud above these universities, making it possible to prevent these administrative issues. But of course, you can organize virtual mobility also with enrollment of students and all. So you will get more on these good practices soon. You see here, we have the four categories as I just introduced them to you, but we have also here related initiatives. These are quite big initiatives, but do not fit the four categories. First of all, that is the Erasmus Virtual Exchange Pilot Project. This virtual exchange is organized by the European Commission. It's running for 2 years now, and there are tens of thousands of students already involved in this. We don't consider them this as virtual mobility, as just described, because it is not between universities. These are learning platforms for people-to-people, person-to-person dialogues on cultural topics between European youngsters, not necessarily even students, but youngsters, with youngsters at Northern African countries. And then they are talking about women's rights or cultural differences and so on. Some parts have ECTS, but the bigger part is purely for a dialogue in this virtual exchange. And secondly, different from the four categories is here OpenVM, for which tomorrow you get a full introduction and full explanation. But OpenVM here is different because the student is taking here the initiative, not the university for organizing virtual mobility. No, the student is taking a course which is an open course, a MOOC, for example, or an online course which is offered freely by Edinburgh or Twente University. And then afterwards, the student asks for recognition of this course at the university. So this is an open virtual mobility, we call that. Interesting from this OpenVM project is that they have specifically looked into the skills of mobility. It's introduced the skills of virtual mobility, but there's a strong overlap here with physical mobility. We are talking about students gaining skills of intercultural skills and attitudes, network learning skills, active self-regulated learning skills, autonomy-driven learning, interactive collaborative learning, and open-mindedness. This is all worked out and also presented tomorrow. I think what is speaking to your imagination is, for example, that a student working in a virtual mobility scheme, the student can guide a full team online on objective set or on shared responsibilities and so on. So this teamwork online, you can't gain these skills in a physical mobility. And we consider these skills very important for multinationals, for future cooperation within companies on working, managing teams online, which is certainly a skill you can gain from these virtual mobility programs. Okay, from the stakeholder session that I introduced before, we have looked into opportunities and barriers for virtual mobility. And first of all, opportunities for students, staff, and universities. First of all, for students, it's about more flexibility, better accessibility for potentially all students, right? Not because you don't have to be physically mobile, all students potentially can join a virtual mobility program. It's also enriching your individual portfolio because you can take courses at any time from another university, but also from more universities than one. So that's different from physical mobility. It's about competence building, just like the skills I just introduced to you that are connected to mobility. It offers you long-term intermittent mobility. It becomes a continuing part of your educational career. And you can always take that mobility part. And in the end, it contributes to improving your employability. Looking at the opportunities for staff, it is about enhancing the quality of the course and curriculum by enriching it with the work of and material from other universities. Also, you can agree with staff researchers from other universities that you together work on a program where the one university focuses on that part of research, you are focusing on that part of research, and you get a kind of specialization, which is in the benefit of the students and the offerings of your universities, of course, if you have a specialization in a certain field of research connected with other universities. You learn certainly also from working with other international colleagues. You enhance the teaching skills by using new modes of teaching, and that is, of course, also in the benefit of your career. For the institutions, the universities, it's important that they expand the university's academic offer in an international context. You use innovative pedagogies, learn to work with offering new modes of teaching also in connection with other universities. You improve the quality in all, you network with other universities, enhance the attractiveness, competitiveness of your university by showing to students that you are not the university only, but you're connected with many other universities. And also you can address more alumni and disadvantaged groups by this. In short, there are also some barriers with the mobility and virtual mobility. Of course, you need to have a kind of digital competencies from your staff to make these programs really work well and attractive. There is still a lack of awareness and experience and expertise in this field. Of course, you're facing new administrative issues by working with different universities. Time zones can differ. You have some linguistic barriers, and you have to come to digital maturity, but you have to start somewhere and build this digital maturity on the go. Then my final slide is about conclusions on this. Conclusion is that education can be organized face-to-face, blended, or by online modes only, also with mobility. So ICT modes of teaching and learning amplify the potential of education and the mobility related to it. But I want to emphasize that none of the forms of mobility is an alternative replacing the other. This was certainly a concern by the students. They were afraid that the European Student Union was afraid that with virtual mobility, we would have a very cheap model of organizing mobility and that it would be competing with physical mobility. No, each form of mobility has its own added value and their own schemes of operation, and also skills that you gain. So they have to be operational next to each other, and preferably even strengthen each other. They can be, like I said, they can be offered separately or in combination. The sequence of physical blended and online you can play with. This can be should be part of the curriculum. And in the end, I want to indicate that for European university initiatives, we are also as key partner, EADTU's key partner in the OpenU project for the development of the Bloom Hub, and we want to extend this and promote virtual mobility also by this hub. This for closing my presentation, and also for those at this moment, I would like to ask you if you have examples of virtual mobility from your university or you know of, and please send them to us. We would like to include them into our categorization of virtual mobility examples. So please do, and we have a dedicated website where you can find all this information. And I'm asking Fenna if she can put this link of the EADTU website in the chat. We have this website on for virtual mobility recently launched. And if you have an example from yourself, we can include it there. So you see there is the link on our dedicated virtual mobility website. Before I go to the first presentation of good practices, are there any questions from from the audience at this moment. I'm going in the QA mode. Ah, well, yeah, I'm sorry, the Spanish, my Spanish is not well enough. Ah, yeah, looks like it would, well, it's a nice environment. It's clicking there. Any brand expanding overseas is clicking. Well, actually, I know that there are some virtual mobility examples with Latin America from UNED, the Spanish Open University, with Latin America and also Asia. There are some examples there. Quite sure I can connect you with some people from UNED who have examples from virtual mobility outside Europe with Asia. From Israel, I'm wondering how you provide the retaliation of the lectures who transform the courses since there is a work done besides organic frontal course. I'm wondering how you provide. Not sure if I understand the question correctly. I hope I can explain it by indicating that this is the development of these courses and programs is all for students. It's a virtual visit to the other universities. To develop them, we often see that the staff is visiting the other staff members once a year to discuss the program, the programming, and work together. So it is really. The staff needs to be engaged in organizing this. How can people from schools benefit from these ideas?
I think the other questions we should save until 12.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah. No, it's really tempting to go through all the questions, but we keep them. We're not ignoring them. We keep them until 12 o'clock. And to keep the time, we now go to the first presentation of a good practice under the embedded mobility within a course. And we have several speakers there. We start with, I believe, Christian Stracke, explain the virtual mobility course on instructional design and as an example of embedded mobility within a course. So please, Christian, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, George. I hope that you can hear me very well. And welcome to all. It's our great pleasure to be here with you and to be selected as one of the cases of good practice. We are very honored by that. I'm not alone, and we will share the presentation among us. You will see that it is a presentation by three universities, University of Uvascula, FernUniversität in Hagen, and Open University of the Netherlands. And these three universities have joined efforts, and we will just give you a short introduction what we have done, and before we will dive into that, let me simply show you the agenda of our presentation. We hope that we can manage to also keep some time in the end for your questions, and we will be happy to answer them. We will briefly introduce the virtual mobility pilot that we have designed together. Then we will go a little bit deeper into the practical design and implementations. We will give you an overview of the evaluation that we have done, and we will also share with you the outcomes and the lessons learned. Well, we have planned our virtual mobility already 3 years ago, and it is not only one time that is taking place, but is now the second run that we have started, just finished last week. And we were very happy to welcome students from three universities. And most of all, and most important for us, was that we have here a design that is done together in close collaboration of the three universities, as well as with mutual acceptance by all universities. That means the course is run by all three universities. It is accepted, and you will get as a student official ECTS credit points for your own study. And it is always a course that is mixing up the students. That means you have always international group work and teams from students from the three universities. That was also something that was very important for us. This second run is about 6 weeks due to the planning for that. And the first run was about 8 weeks, and you will learn more about that in a second. Okay, we will have here now the general task for the students, that was to design, create, and evaluate an interactive digital product for education. And you will learn in a minute what does it mean and what the students have to be done. And finally, we just followed the definition of virtual mobility defined by EADTU last year, as we also believe that virtual mobility is and should be an innovation, not only in the form and in the way how it is presented, but also in the pedagogical design, that we need a new learning scenario and new methodologies to allow students also to facilitate their own self-regulated virtual learning in international teams. Having said that, I'd like to hand over to my colleagues, and now we will simply start here with the next slide, but at the moment I cannot move on. Manu, the floor is yours. I don't know what happened. I cannot hear anything anymore, and I don't know if you have lost me. Panu, can you take over, please?
I'm not sure why Panu is not connecting at the moment. I think he just now left the presenter's room and
Okay. Sorry for that. Sana, would you like to take over, or otherwise I can continue?
Yeah, I think as you already have so many speakers, maybe please continue, and then Panu can step in at some point. Maybe it takes too long otherwise.
Yeah, fine with me. Go ahead, Sana.
Okay, Sana.
Okay,
Sana. Okay, I just unlocked her mic and camera, so she should be able to talk. Okay. Panu is not here anymore. I don't
see
him.
Okay, I think I'm online now.
Yes, you are.
Yes.
The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Okay. I think Panu, he went out. Okay, our goals with this course was that we have an authentic task that the students will design, they will create and evaluate the interactive digital product that they will do for education. And the main point here was that we want the international cooperation with the between different universities, and then the internationalization and mobility opportunities for less mobile students, so the e-learning courses can be taken from home. Panu, you want to step in?
Yes, sorry okay. for that. For some reason, it didn't allow me to turn the microphone on. I have to reconnect for the setting. So like Christian and probably Sanna already said, our task is basically one that is genuinely fitting for this sort of virtual mobility. So if you think about designing, creating, and evaluating interactive digital educational product, we can do it locally in traditional forms, but it is good fit for this sort of virtual mobility where we are doing things in three different places and online, of course. And with this topic and task in mind, we can also look that we have three different other goals or cornerstones for our production. So first of all, of course, this offers a different sort of mobility possibilities for persons in master or adult learners who might have some other restricting things like family or vocational commitments, making it difficult to participate long-term traditional mobility. So first of all, this is a good opportunity to mix things and provide other opportunities within programs. To be honest, that might not be the most important reason for us or our experience. And actually, I think that the biggest gain from our project comes from this sort of natural feel of that the course topic really fits with international cooperation. So we can actually have a much more broader expert base because three universities, three staff groups provide different views and different perspectives. We can offer those for our students, but maybe even more importantly, our students come from various different backgrounds. So we have Open University students, master degree program students, and these are mixed from different universities. So we are providing genuinely relevant and timely interaction, web-based interaction and collaboration. And sort of simply the structure enables this sort of genuine teamwork that we can actually see in emerging around the globe in times like these, especially and in general in the 2020. Our course is quite tight. It's around 6 weeks of intensive collaborations. And if you just look the brief outline of the week headlines, on the first weeks, we do focus quite a lot on creating and facilitating spaces for interaction and collaboration. And we feel that this needs to be emphasized because most of the students, they don't, of course, know each other coming from different universities. And like Christian said, that we are doing this sort of intentional mixing of the groups. So trying to give as broad grouping as possible from different backgrounds. So we need to focus on facilitating the interaction and creating spaces basically online for students. Students might be using additional tools like Trello or Slack or something else that they bring themselves, but we provide the basic tools during the first weeks and support it as we can, basically. And students are directed to get to know each other and then focus on the task at hand. And basically during the last weeks, we change our emphasis of facilitation and direction instruction to more giving feedback on the educational concept and then building the prototype in the end. In whole, 6 weeks, and this sort of course is quite intensive and tight, and students do comment that too, but so far we have found it working quite well and gained also some positive feedbacks and students have generally managed to handle the timeline because we only have few mandatory points in a week and they can otherwise arrange their interaction within the smaller student groups. So thank you and good move now for Sanna.
Okay, then I will tell you how we designed the pilot. First of all, we wanted the students to have an authentic task that they will solve in this course. So it will give them more motivation, and it will bring them more intensive to work on that project. Then we use collaborative learning, and as Panu and I think even Christian said, that we had international groups, so we divided the students so that each university students won't be in the same group, all of them. So all the different university students will join each other in different groups. Then we use Moodle as a learning platform, which all the information was, and then we use collaborative rooms for synchronous meetings. Then we choose some Salmon activities to use in the course, since they enable the active and participative online learning for the groups and the students. So we use a different variety of design solutions and presentation modes in the Moodle environment. And then how we implemented the activities is that we gave the student a task. That the task is to plan and develop and also evaluate an interactive digital product for education, since some of the students are already teaching or they want to be teachers, so we want them to create a project together for the educational purposes. We provided three different tools. We provided Seppo, House Space, and Uplay. And out of these tools, the students and the groups were able to decide which one they want to use for the prototype. And the working format was that the group that we, as a the teachers, we divided, and then the group was supposed to organize themselves. They work. We provided them collaborate rooms in the Moodle for face-to-face meetings, but they were also allowed to use other media or other tools for discussing each other. And I think lots of them also did use other tools for that. Okay, then I will hand over to Kate.
First run, because from the second run the evaluation is taking part currently, because the project ended last week. So we're going to present some informal things about this run, but I want to point out something from the last run. It's a bit like lessons learned, but you will see. So what we found out from the first run is that our students need a lot of guidance through the course. Like already mentioned, we only had to have 6 weeks, which is a very rough schedule. So we had issues in the first run that the students were thrown into this course, and their lack of guidance. So that's what we took care about the second run, that we take them by hand and lead through the whole course. So if you plan something like this, please keep in mind that the backgrounds are completely different. Not every student used to work with maybe Moodle or another platform. So yeah, we had to experience this. Then the second aspect is that from our three universities, we had to find a time slot which was possible for all of us. And the first time slot was in winter, and we had a winter break during this course. And this was a feedback from the students that it was not possible for all of them to work during the winter break. So we were different learning and working cultures. Some of them expected other students to work during the break. And now we avoided this winter break and shifted the whole experience to spring, which is a better, so without any breaks, or we had one or two holidays, but this was much more better than with winter break. Then we had live meetings during the course, but not every week, and not every live meeting explained the task which was given during the weeks, and we changed that. So every week we had, every week at the same day, at the same time, we had a live meeting where the tasks of the weeks were explained and where the students can point, can ask some questions regarding the task and regarding what they have to do and on the current status. And the last aspect that I want to mention, which I think is really important, or was an important experience for us, is, like you said, like you've seen, we have 6 weeks, and nearly every week had different content. And the first time we said that every university is going to provide one weekly content. So maybe FernUni Universität took care of week 5 regarding evaluation, and curricula took care of the educational concept in week 3. And the students experienced a lack of consistency between these weeks because every university had a different way of teaching and facilitating the students. And because of that, we to the next round, to the next phase, we switched this the groups, so the facilitating teams. So now week 3 was provided by, the educational concept was provided by a team of every facilitators from every university to get a more consistent course. I've got to keep time. And very shortly, very briefly, ideas from this run is that we still have needs from the student to get more in contact with each other. So we had, I think, 6 groups, and they want to have more content, more contact between each other. That's the one point. And the second point was that, my slide is gone. Thank you. And the second point was that we were thinking about short feedback in every live meeting from the students to implement that to get to know how the current process is. And now I'm going to hand over to Kate.
Thank you. I hope you can hear me. Yeah. And well, I'm going to talk about this last run and the improvements and the student feedback in that. So first of all, let's start with the, well, direct feedback that we got after the course. First of all, clarity and simplicity of design is what matters a lot to students. Something may be easy to follow and, well, seemingly uncomplicated to us tutors, but maybe kind of fairly complex to the students. So the storyline and, well, everything as easily explained as possible is really the king. We noticed that students were more engaged and they wanted to go further than we expected them to go, which is amazing, in fact. So their motivation was higher than we expected, and they were expecting more qualitative and deeper evaluation from us to give more feedback to their peers. And also they wanted to understand the peers' concepts better, and the products they were evaluating much better. Apart from that, collaboration between the teams of students, so not only within the teams, but also between the teams, was also important, and students found it really valuable. So we had to cluster students, make them also discuss their own projects with the other teams, and in this way they learned really a lot. And that's why they were also so interested in others' projects, and they could learn from that experience. And of course, mentoring and monitoring students' work was much deeper and much more important than we could think it was. And students reported that they did not think that they needed that close mentoring from the teachers at the beginning of the course, but at the end of it, they realized the huge opportunities there. So that was really, really interesting to us. And this is something you would also want to take into account, how to best monitor students' feedback and their work. We were also thinking about creating the different ways of asking students on the go, like polls or blitz questionnaires, just a few questions during online sessions, and more frequently within the course, just to know what they feel like. Right, and let's continue to the next slide, which I can't move, but overall, both we as teachers and the students reported increased motivation and they learned a lot in different domains and areas. So first of all, let's talk about what students learned. They, the obvious things are collaborating and co-creating in an international team, the skill that cannot be substituted by anything else. Apart from that, the
experiencing this, but final, yeah, you're back. Okay, well, Katrina's back. No, so there must be some disturbance on the line there, I guess. I'm happy to see that this really shows that this is really an example that really worked as an international experience, as Katrina was explaining. Doesn't look like she is able to join us again at this point. Seeing the time, I think we keep the questions for our 12 o'clock discussion session. And I want to thank the presenters from this first example, of course, all together, four speakers, for the contribution. And as I said, we come back to possible questions at 12 o'clock. Let's continue with Nadja Gmelch from the VOC, the Universitat Oberta de Catalunya, with a presentation on the opportunity for inclusive and sustainable internationalization. Nadja, please, the floor is yours. See Nadja, some problems with logging in. It worked when we checked when you were there. Otherwise, nothing happening from Nadja's part. Otherwise, maybe you have to log in, log out, log in.
To present, or maybe that will help. The presenter. Maybe it will take some time to load. microphone and camera are unlocked, so I don't know.
Yeah, very good point. So, otherwise, maybe Nadja needs to log out and log in again, and maybe you can say that in the chat. Shall we otherwise go to the next presenter on network curricula and mobility windows? That would be Tom Gorman.
Yeah.
Would you be ready for your presentation now? Then in the meantime, we try to get Nadja back in.
Okay, let me see. Tom, he's here. ST Tom, make presenter.
I need to get the right slides for Tom.
Yes, Tom.
Great. Tom, is your system working?
Let's see.
Looks like it. Hello, Tom. Welcome.
Hello.
Hi, yeah, we can hear you. Thanks for your flexibility. So we start now with network curricula with an example from Tom Gorman of Coventry University. Please, Tom, you have the floor, sir.
Okay, just checking that you can hear and see me before I start. Is this okay? This is always an odd experience. I'm going to talk about a project called Immersive Telepresence in Theatre, which is a joint project we've been running since, well, the planning started in 2015, but the project started running in 2016 between Tampere University in Finland and Coventry University right in the centre of the UK. I should explain, this is quite an ambitious slideshow. I'm going to show quite a few clips, so I hope they're going to work. So if we move on to, I can click on the next slide, I think, and it should change. Okay, let me just presentation. The slides aren't changing for me for some reason. Nope. Ooh. No, I seem to be on the program slide for some reason.
Yeah, I changed it back now.
Ah, here we are. Yeah. Here we are. Yeah, this always bodes well. A very technical project. A quote from Clay Shirky. We almost really didn't set out to do a virtual mobility program. This, in fact, was a Skype lecture that got out of hand. It began with me being sent over on an Erasmus mobility to Tampere to talk about the possibility of maybe doing some Skype lectures. But as the conversation grew over dinner, we decided that we wanted to do something with Shakespeare. And the Finnish students wanted to look at Shakespeare in English. And we decided to do a joint project. But to be honest, we had no real idea even what telepresence was. In fact, in its first year, it wasn't even called telepresence in theatre. It was called a virtual stage. But I'll define telepresence first, just in case the term is unfamiliar. Brenda Laurel called it a medium that allows you to take your body with you into another environment. And telepresence really exists in the realm of business communications. It's not really in the realm of the arts. And in fact, very few of us in the arts do very much in terms of online learning. We've been forced into it, of course, recently with the pandemic. So there's quite a bit of it at the minute. But traditionally, we don't really, because we're very visceral and very physical. If I go to the next slide, we've got a short clip that explains sort of visually what it is that we do. So there's just a YouTube clip, and let's see if this works.
In the end, I was really surprised how immersive it could be to act out a scene just with this screen in as the connector.
But once you get used to it, kind of felt that we were in the same room. All the distance got smaller and smaller.
It's made the world seem smaller, it's more accessible.
Yeah, I love it. I do. I can't get enough of it.
I genuinely love this project. Yeah. I love how unique it is.
So really, this was a great way to bring people from other countries together in the same room, really, and open up new possibilities for future projects. I feel like this is very beneficial for us thinking about the future. Now we have all these new people in our lives who live in another country.
It's a worthy tool, and it should never be thought of as a gimmick. It's a good tool.
And once we got the hold of it, it was really like a very magical experience, almost.
To have these
people in the same room with you, and also it's another country, life-sized.
We all sort of came together as sort of like kids in a playground. Mm. And kids make friends without a worry, and we all sort of jumped at each other like and made friends.
So it was quite exciting, the whole experiment. So I really felt that we met personally and during the virtual lessons that we were in the same room and the distance got smaller and smaller. Yeah, I'm repeating myself.
Okay. So that should give you an overview of what the project actually resembled, but we had several challenges to face, and a lack of knowledge really about what we were doing. We started with Skype, but Skype couldn't provide a full body view, so it wasn't really suitable for acting or group interaction. Our initial idea were the students were going to be paired one-on-one via Skype. We tried Google Hangouts, and eventually, after consulting with numerous technicians from all over the place, we ended up in a wind tunnel in Coventry and a drama studio in Temperley. So we had to build the space. So we used what we had to hand, which were large rear projection screens. We used sound and lighting from theatre spaces, and we managed to get our hands on polycoms, which are more commonly found in boardrooms for meetings. The first year was rough and ready. The first year we made lots of mistakes, and we also, as I will explain, used other apps and social media as well to try and get this illusion of a unified space, which again, we kind of almost stumbled across accidentally through building the space. We discovered that we could make eye contact, etc. So if I go to the next slide, slide 5, hopefully it'll go there. No, nothing happening. Fenna, can you get me to the next slide? Nope. Presentation. Nothing's happening there. Oh, back to program again. I'll continue talking anyway, and hopefully the next slide will appear. In the next slide, I was going to look at the requirements for working in this way. Ah, here we are. And these are the four key things we thought about in terms of collaborating in the arts in this way. Ease of use. We really didn't know what we were doing at the start. Our technicians knew a little bit more than we did. But Polycom or H323, Cisco, etc., is the easiest of these systems to use. There are a lot of competing systems such as Lola, UltraGrid, and at the very end I'll talk about the system we use now, which is probably the most complex of the systems. Audio video quality for performers and actors, they need to be able to see each other clearly and hear each other clearly. There were problems in the first year with echo. As I said, we were in a wind tunnel. which is a very echoey space, and video conferencing technology has echo cancellation, but it can only actually cancel one echo at a time, and we were in a very echoey space. So since that point, we've kind of moved into acoustically quite solid spaces. Latency, which I'll talk about in a little second, but we all are experiencing this in our kind of lockdown states. And accessibility, in that with this particular way of working, both institutions need matching technology. So H323 Polycom will only talk to H323 Polycom, LoLa will only talk to LoLa, Nimbra will only talk to Nimbra. So it's a bit like being in a world where if you had an Apple iPhone, you could only actually talk to another Apple iPhone. You couldn't talk to a Samsung, for example. So I'll go to the next slide, talk a little bit about latency, bandwidth, and jitter, which are the banes of working this way. And the metaphor I've been using, although I'm sure you all are overly familiar with this if you've been working in Zoom recently, is not all computers are equal. And the metaphor I've been using to kind of explain this to people who aren't particularly technical is the pizza delivery metaphor. If you order a pizza, you want a warm pizza. You don't want cold pizza. And numerous things can affect you getting your pizza warm. So the longer the road, obviously the longer the pizza is going to take to get to you. Your bandwidth, which actually is probably the most important factor, the number of lanes on the road. And at the minute, work of this kind is only really possible inside academic institutions that have the kind of bandwidth. And you've also got jitter. You're sharing your connection with Excel spreadsheets and cat videos and social media posts. And it tends to be very non-discerning in terms of what signal gets through first. And, you know, basically the science bit is the speed of light in the vacuum is 186,282 miles per second. But through fiber, which is the best we can expect, is it's 31% slower. And everything you have in a room will also create latency. So your camera will create latency, your microphones will create latency, your projector will create latency. So the work we do now is to try and eliminate latency as much as we can. And there you see a kind of rough, this is a network map between Coventry and Tampere, and these are just some of the switches we go through to get the signal there and back. And as you can see, we go one way and we come back a different way. And all of these switches are slowing us down by milliseconds. But in this world where instantaneous reaction is necessary, and they reckon that 20 milliseconds latency is the equivalent of playing 20 feet apart. 40 milliseconds latency is about 40 feet apart. So there's a certain point where latency becomes unworkable, where latency leads to incredibly delayed reactions. The next video clip will show two things. It will show us testing latency between Hong Kong and Finland. So you'll see the most extreme example. And then a game that we played in the very first instance in 2016 called Grandmother's Footsteps, where we first encountered latency and the limitations of what we could do. So hopefully this will explain our struggles with latency in the first few years.
Latency, we can have a little demonstration of latency. So Nico, if you count in 1, 2, 3 clap, and we get everyone here to clap. Okay? I'll count it in. I'll count. So when we get to 3, everyone here clap. So I'm tired as well. And then you'll hear the difference. So 1, 2, 3. Yeah.
Everybody! Yeah,
because of the delay, but... Because of the delay, she can see everybody. Because they can't see when she's turning, and she's turning when everybody's moving already. And you still... See her, yes. But basically, she sees everybody move.
Okay. So I'll move on to the next slide from that, which is the setup of the space. And I'll just quickly go through those two. How do I get back to the slides? So anyway, I'll keep talking and hopefully the slide will appear again magically. So this is the, and we have a website, everything's on. I mean, this is not, we're not like Kentucky Fried Chicken. This is not a secret. This is open source stuff. So we used a Polycom system at the very beginning. It has to be networked in a particular way. So it needs to, if possible, go around the university firewall, but there are very safe ways of doing that. So that if it is hacked, the university will not lose any personal or sensitive information. There are speakers behind the screen, which give the illusion that the sound is actually coming from the screen. And again, they're balanced in both areas as well. And all the technology apart from the camera is hidden. So the camera is in the center of the screen, and I'll show you what it looks like. We actually put the screen flush to the floor, so we don't use screen stands. Because we discovered this gives the illusion of the floor continuing into the next room, which is psychologically very important. The camera is just around waist height because we've discovered as well that that gives the illusion of eye contact. So when the participants are standing a few feet back from it, it does give the sense that you are making eye contact with the person on the other side of the room. And as much as possible, we've decided to light both rooms in the same way to give the illusion that it is a kind of continuous space. It's built in pre-existing rooms that the students are familiar with using as well. So the only thing that's changed, it is now an international collaboration, so the participants on the other side of the room to a certain extent are your colleagues there. We also used Adobe Connect for a series of online lectures delivered from both institutions. And I should emphasize that this is team teaching. So both institutions teach together, often in the same space at the same time. So it is a true exchange. We now use Zoom. We've used Zoom for the last 2 years because it's cheaper and actually does exactly the same job. But we gave the students their own Zoom rooms now, but Adobe Connect rooms back then so that they could rehearse their scenes together. And we also used Facebook. So if you look at it as a kind of a three-room metaphor, Facebook was functioning very much as our notice board, where we were sharing schedules, scripts, photographic images, research stuff. Students were also using that to become friends with their scene partners and to arrange their own rehearsal times using Adobe Connect or Zoom. And of course, they used it in various different ways as well. The next clip I'm going to show is from King Lear Online, which is the next year. And it's a series of classes. So in this year, we improved latency. So you'll notice that we're able to sing together, and we have a yoga class and a martial arts class as well. So hopefully you'll get a sense of how the project had advanced in 1 year, because at that point we really started to drill into how the technology worked.
And then you start to rock yourself forward and backwards and try to balance yourself. Try to find the balance of today. It's okay if it was something different yesterday, but the balance of today. And quite fast you can notice that you have to keep your knees a little bit bent.
Isantale, 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 Knee and the other arm goes back to the floor and stay there. And think of letting every in-breath lengthening gently the spine and maybe the out-breath.
We should now spend approximately an hour doing some kind of exercises with our body and mind. And every time thought emerges, take it. Is it about coffee or tea or that I'm bored or anything? Take the thought and pass it along. Imagine the ball. Lift it with your back. Pass it along. Imagine the ball. Here.
So it really, you never get to the full extent. You always leave some movement at the ends. So I'm not going all closed, but I'm leaving a little bit. And same thing with here. I'm not going, I don't extend to 100%. I'm leaving a little bit at the ball.
Okay, so that hopefully gives you a flavor of the work we did in the second year. I have one final clip to show you of what we did this year, just as the pandemic was starting. But this was a clip, and this is no longer unusual, so I might have to stop using this clip, because I'm sure we've all been to a Zoom party now. But the students used these spaces as social spaces as well. At Coriolanus, we didn't meet up at the end. Sometimes we have blended mobility, where we were meant to go to Tampere in Finland in March this year. But just as we were doing the project, obviously the lockdown happened in both the UK and in Finland. So the students didn't get to go, and they're still bitterly disappointed about this because they'd been looking forward to it for 3 years. But in the very first year, the students all went out for a beer, and it made us realize that there's more to this system than just the classes, that giving them the tools, so giving them Zoom or Adobe Connect and Facebook as a social space, really was changing the dynamics in the main space as well. But they had tasks, they had to run the scenes, they had to learn lines. And we noticed for the first 2 days, and this has happened every year that we do this, students are quite camera shy, in that they tend to do their piece of work and then they avoid the camera. Once they've kind of got to know each other in these other spaces, in Facebook and in Zoom, then it's very hard to get them out of the way of the camera because they want to keep talking and talking and talking. And we even leave it on during lunchtime. They have lunch together. They had a karaoke competition this year as well. So I was running late, I got stuck in traffic, and the students filled the time by having a karaoke competition. So these are the problems. I'll just kind of conclude now with what we're doing now. Solutions are expensive, and someone posted in the chat, they're expensive. Yes, but an initial investment actually works out quite cheap in the long run. So if you're going to start with a kind of basic thing like a Polycom, they're about £11,000, but they last for years. We collaborated with Purdue University, and they used a Polycom from 2003. So and it worked absolutely fine. So they last for years. They're not like iPhones. They don't really go out of fashion. And there are other, if you're more tech savvy, solutions like Lola, which are PC based and require some knowledge of programming, which are really, really effective. You do need very good technicians working on this, and you need good technicians on both sides. And there needs to be a level of communication between these technicians in terms of just getting the network where it needs to be. Plugging the stuff in is relatively easy. Networking and talking to the university IT departments to get the connection sorted can take quite a bit of work. Our networks are slowing us down is the problem as well. And display technology is slow as well, and we're completely dependent on the Ethernet. Will 5G change this? Possibly. It's too early to say. What we use now is a system called an Imbra Media Server, which is quite expensive. It's used across Europe for things like Amazon Prime and Netflix. It's used a lot in telecom. It's also the Bundesliga in Germany use it as well to link up all their stadia. But we became members of an organization called the Nordic Center for Digital Presence, which is a series of arts and university academic organizations that have all linked themselves up through NIMBRA. So there's a map. You can see Coventry is the sole one in the United Kingdom. There are plenty of other NIMBRAs, but these are just the NIMBRAs that have been used for arts, culture, or education. And it really is a fantastic solution. It's technically very complicated. It takes quite a bit of the learning curve is huge, and we discovered this ourselves in doing it. But there's a very good support network there that you can kind of plug into. And it's incredibly fast and high quality. And once it's set up, it's a one-switch solution. So I'll show a very quick clip of it in operation this year, and then I'll conclude because I'm running out of time. So this is just the first session meeting, great, and hopefully, I know we're all on browsers, but the audio and video quality and the latency are absolutely superb. So we're in high definition, we're actually at 720p. We could go up as far as 4K if we had the bandwidth. The latency is around 100 milliseconds, which is absolutely superb, which means that you can sing together. It's expensive, but there are educational discounts, and we found the NIMBRA people, because it's not commonly used in education, they found a market for it through the Nordic Center for Digital Presence, which is growing. And once it's set up, it is a question of, you don't even have to turn anything on. You go into the room, you're already switched on. You just switch on the camera. So I'll stop that and conclude, and we can move to the next presentation. And I'll stay around in case there are any questions at the 12 o'clock session. Thank you very much for that.
Thanks, Tom. Thanks very much, and also for your flexibility to step in just now. It really shows that this is about an actual experience. Of course, it is a very demanding, it's really level. A lot is possible. Thanks, Tom. And we take the questions later on. I'm just happy to see now that Nadja is online, and we immediately go to her presentation on the exchange curricula and exchange mobility. So please, Nadja, the floor is yours.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Sorry for the technical problems before. I wasn't able to press any button, so happy that it works now. Thank you, EADTU, for inviting us to share our experience in this space. Before starting, I would like to say that I'm here, I'm with my colleague Karma, who is one of the members of the virtual mobility groups of EADTU. And so also for the question answer sessions, if there's anything, we will try to answer. And I would like to start with some general reflections that, as we all know, science and higher education is experiencing the corona mode all over the world. And research and study periods are not possible anymore, at least at this moment abroad. And also seminars like we are doing now and other project meetings, everything is developed in online formats. I know that many are hoping for a quick return to normality, But as we know, we cannot really return to normality, as this was the problem, right? So I like to share this image. It's from another context, but it's getting relevant again. So it's and in this context, we know that all our universities and higher education institutions are called upon not to contribute with innovative ideas and actions to frame, I don't like to say the new normality, I just want to say like our future. So it should be actions that contribute also to responsible treatment of our planet Earth, right? So as in all crises, there's this hope and opportunities for change. And I think that we are really in an ideal moment to uptake climate policy impulses and responsibility and try to free international collaboration from the necessity of physical mobility. I know that we cannot really replace 100% the experience of living and studying abroad, but we know, and through our experience, which I'm going to share with you now, we have seen that we can still accomplish many of the objectives that are related to international higher education. So we are really in a precious moment where we should foster digitization a lot more. I mean, what we just saw is really, for me, it's quite futuristic still. It's nice to see that these things are already happening. And yeah, so we should foster more digitization in higher education and also innovative ideas for mobility formats to enrich physical encounters and, where possible, also substitute them. So at the walk at the UOC, the institution I'm working for, we think that this doesn't only contribute to a more sustainable internationalization then, but also to a more inclusive one. And I'm gonna talk about that also in my presentation. So in the coming minutes, basically what I want to share with you our experience in virtual mobilities. We know, and we've just seen, that there are very many different models and options. So this is just our experience, which we can share with you, and hope that will be inspiring for you. So to start with, for those who don't know, the UOC, the Open University of Catalunya, is often proud to say that it is the first fully online university. It was created already 25 years ago. We're actually celebrating our anniversary this year. And we have now over 70,000 students. And you can also see, for example, we have over 8,700 what we call virtual classrooms. So just to give you an idea of the size of our institution. The profile of our students and also graduates is special in the sense that over 90% work and study at the same time. So this is very relevant then to how we try to organize virtual mobilities. And they also reside in over 130 countries all over the world. So I cannot move now the slides. Let's see if it works again. I can push here. Well, it will move at some point. like many other traditional brick and mortar universities, also for our university, we would like to be as international and global as possible. So, but given the profile of our students, which I just mentioned, that the big majority study, work at the same time, they might have a family to take care of. As our president always said, they might have a mortgage to pay. So they might be not as flexible to spend a longer time abroad than other students. And at the same time, given our model, which, as I said, is fully online, so we don't have any face-to-face meetings or classes at our university. So all of this brought us to starting experimenting with virtual mobility some 4 years ago. Our main goal was to try to find innovative formats which could make this international experience, this mobility experience, more accessible to the what we call non-traditional students. So as you also will see, the way we organize these mobilities makes them a relatively easy way of collaborating with other institutions from around the world. A lot easier than probably setting up a joint program, which, as many of you might know, is a very long and difficult encounter. So besides of the goal of increasing internationalization, we also use virtual mobilities to foster the education for global citizenship. I've seen some comment in the chats before reflecting that probably this kind of intercultural experience you cannot have with a virtual mobility. We think you can, because what we generate is then a classroom where we have students from all over the world, and they're in contact also in this classroom. So we think that we can foster at least some of the competences relevant for educating global citizens. And as we've all seen now in the new context that we are living, obviously virtual mobilities can be an opportunity for maintaining some internationalization also in these pandemic times. So what had been the motivation for other universities of working with us realizing virtual mobilities? And many of them have been face-to-face universities. So they saw obviously an international opportunity for their students, but also a way of internationalizing their curriculum. And as many of them probably did not have so much experience in offering online trainings, they thought that this could also be an experience in online learning methodology. So just a broad overview of our experience in virtual mobilities. We had like over 2,000 students since 2017 doing some virtual mobility with us. We did this at different levels, from bachelor to master, but also specialized courses like language courses, and in different formats. So we use the mobility schemes, for example, to complement study programs in home universities and other universities who want to work with us, or as a part of their degree programs or a free choice of modules. So there are many ways of using it. And we've been working with different institutions, from brick and mortar universities to online universities blended. So it's also a way of collaborating with all kind of institutions. So how does it work? In our case, it is not so different probably from a face-to-face mobility. So basically, we have the student enrolled in his or her home university, then coming to the university of destination, doing the mobility, which is then recognized back at the home university. We can do this unidirectional or bidirectional. In our case, as we are fully online, until now we have been working a lot in receiving students in mobility, because we have not found too many universities where we could send them to, also because of language issues and others. But like until now, but we think this is going to change, we had more students coming in. Also, we don't yet offer the mobility directly to students, so we always have to have an agreement with institutions behind it. Then I want to, when the slide changes, I want to share some of the main or key issues that we have found out that we have to take into consideration when setting up a mobility. Many will be very similar to the physical mobility, I suppose. Doesn't move, but it will in a moment. So I would like to just mention, you will then see the whole list, but the idea of what we found very useful is to organize a welcoming session for the students. Because if you do a physical mobility, you come to another country, thank you for moving, you're in another place. So it is quite easy to understand that you're entering another institution. While when you're doing a virtual mobility and you might just change like from your campus, online campus or another online format to, in this case, our campus, it might not be so clear that you're in another environment and that you have to get used to using this environment. So we think it's very useful to have this welcoming session at the beginning. And then, as has been also mentioned before, at the first example, the need of the specific and continuous monitoring to ensure that the students are really following the course. These are the two elements I wanted to highlight. So organizing this kind of mobility has implications at all levels, so academic, organizations, and methodologically. And EADTU asked us to go a bit into detail just to facilitate probably the imagination or idea of how to organize these kinds of mobilities. So first we signed the MOU with the other institution, where we already tried to talk about all the organizational and also economic issues, because as you know, some of us charge student fees, others less. So this all has to be agreed upon in the MOU. Then we start the academic relationship, the work among the peers, analyzing the curriculum and seeing where collaboration could be possible. And we also try to relate or have a reflection on how at the different institutions we evaluate our students, because this is very important then for the recognition of the credits. Then the students come to our campus with this welcome session, which I already mentioned. We try to give them this special mentoring while they are with us. And they take the assessment the way we organize it at our institution. Then they get the credit recognized at their home university, and we have the whole feedback with the students among our institutions to see how it worked and what we can improve. So opportunities and challenges, what we found in these last years, they're very much in line to what George already said in his introductory presentation. So we think that for students, definitely having the chance of doing online and mobile virtual mobilities gives them more access to international experiences. Also to the students who normally would probably not be able to move, being it of family reasons, of economic reasons, or whatever reason. We think that, what I said before, it is definitely an opportunity for developing global competences and language competences and digital competences, obviously. The recognition of credits is an opportunity for students, widening their curriculum and the offer that they can encounter at their home universities. And as in any other mobility, we think the opportunity is obviously to have the contact with faculty and peers in other learning resources also. For universities, many of us are trying to work for a more democratic internationalization with a wider impact. So we think that mobilities in an online environment can contribute to that. As I said before, for us, they are more agile and effective to collaborate than developing long process for joint programs, for example. And we also see that it fosters the international collaboration of our faculty. because we run short of time, I will go to the last slide. The challenge is the same, very much in line with what George said. The biggest is for the student the need to adapt to this new context and understanding the different norms, the methodologies, and also how their learning will be assessed. It's often difficult to combine different academic calendars, and students really need a lot of willpower and autonomy. You already need this when you're studying online or at distance at your home institution, but being still in another context, you really want to do it to do it until the end. And for the universities, obviously we're all different, so we have to face these specific necessities, and the different ways of assessing the learning has to be agreed upon. We have to find ways to combine our calendars. We have to ensure also that the classes where we let our international students in have some global curriculum, not too locally focused. And we need global competencies also of our staff, of our faculty, and the administrative support teams. So this was the experience I wanted to share with you. I'm happy to answer your questions in relation to anything you have a doubt on, or yeah, so looking forward to that. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks, Nadja. Happy that you were still able to join. We solved it easily with just changing the order. Thanks so much for the experience of the book. Looking at the clock, I think we first finished the presentations, and then in the meantime, we are collecting all the questions, and we have, of course, some time after the final presentation, which is given by Irina Perni from Tampere University on the joint master's class in comparative social policy and welfare. So, Evelina, the floor is yours.
Still loading.
For me, it seems that it's okay. Everything is green, but can you hear me? Okay, great. I can't hear if somebody's if somebody's replying to me, but I can see the comments. So basically, I was asked to present our joint master's degree program in comparative social policy and welfare. I am Evelina Permi. I'm a study specialist at the Faculty of Social Sciences at Tampere University in Finland. And I have been working with this program almost from the beginning. It initiated already in 2006. Let's see if I can. No. I would need the slide before this one, but I can't. Yeah, this one. Thank you. So I joined this project, or like 1 year after it had started. So almost from the beginning. Originally, we had three partner universities: university from Tampere, Johannes Kepler University, Linz from Austria, and Mykolas Romeris University from Lithuania. The cooperation started as Erasmus teacher exchange. So our Lithuanian colleagues had been doing teacher exchange to both universities and started the discussions about possibly creating a joint program. And these discussions were brought together, and then eventually we decided to start the development of this program. We applied for Erasmus Curriculum Development Funding in 2006 in order to build the curriculum and also to develop online learning. So this online or virtual aspect was a key element in this program right from the beginning. So we were successful in our application and were able to start the planning process, and everything developed quite quickly, and we were able to have our first cohort of students already in 2008. And since then, we've had an admission every second year. In the beginning, we also applied for Erasmus Intensive Program funding to cover the costs of the physical mobility. Let's see. Well, during the last year, we have had some organizational changes in the program, and from next autumn onwards, the program will be run by our university and Johannes Kepler University, Linz. In this process, we have also revised the curriculum, but the key elements of like the mobility structure will remain the same. I will shortly show briefly our curriculum. We have jointly agreed as admission requirements, so they are the same in both universities, but we have separate admission procedures for the students. This admission is international, so it's not limited to students coming from our two universities. Anyone can apply, anyone who fulfills the admission criteria. After we have taken care of the admission procedures, the students are registered in both universities. So they have a home university where they are a degree student, and then in the partner university, they are registered as exchange students. We have aimed for a joint degree, but this has not been possible so far due to national legislations. We will see if it will be possible in the future. So the students eventually receive a national degree. We have been able to add information about the partner university and about the joint program to the graduation document. So it's still quite clear that the degree has been completed in a joint program. There is also a possibility for those students studying whose home university is Johannes Kepler University in Linz to apply for a double degree from Tampere. So, the joint study path. So, our curriculum is designed so that all the students follow the same curriculum. There are only very minor differences in the individual study plans of the students. And each of the semesters contains study units from both partner universities. The fourth semester is dedicated to master's thesis, and there's also during that semester, there's a possibility to receive supervision from both universities. We have some elective or optional elements in the curriculum where students can make individual choices. We provide them a list of courses where they can choose from. These elective studies can be provided by our two universities, but we have now in the new curriculum also added some new elements where students can choose some courses from some other virtual learning networks. These are at the moment mainly Finnish networks, since they were since our university is a member of several virtual Finnish virtual learning networks, where they are there's suitable content for our program. Only a couple of study units are organized fully or partly locally, such as scientific writing. Well, internship is, of course, quite an individual study unit. And thesis seminar, it's organized locally, but we also have joined seminar sessions during the program. So here is our curriculum. It, I'm not sure if you're able to view it. Probably it's the writing is quite small there. But basically, the first three modules are organized so that all students follow the courses at the same time. In elective classes, they then make their own choices and thus divert from the joint path. Then they do an internship in some point of their studies, and then finally they also work together in the thesis seminar. Well, right from the beginning, the program has been built around two forms of mobility. We have physical and virtual mobility, and all courses of the curriculum are built around the mobility scheme, basically. So during the two-year program, our students and staff meet 3 to 4 times, about 6 weeks in total, these are called intensive programs. We have in the beginning of each semester an intensive program where we provide introductory lectures or seminars, workshops for the courses of that semester. During the first IP, we also provide the students some guidelines on how to use the online tools during the program. And we go through ethical guidelines, which are maybe even like they, of course, they are important in all studies, but maybe in a virtual format, it's even more important to go through these ethical guidelines. Then we also include some social program because it's very important for the students to get to know each other. It's definitely a benefit for the online or the virtual part of the program if the students are at least to some extent familiar with each other. In the second year IPs, we also have master's thesis seminars. these are usually very intensive, and the students often say that they are exhausted after reading through everybody else's thesis plans and thesis drafts and commenting, and but they also find them really fruitful. And then they find it easier to continue working online. These IP sessions are planned jointly, but then the host, we take turns in organizing them, and the host university then provides the necessary services for all. We cover the expenses of the physical mobility from several means, several sources. We use Erasmus Teacher Exchange funding for the mobility of the teachers, Erasmus internship funding for students' internship periods. Students cover some of the costs by themselves, but we also provide some university scholarships and travel grants. We also have the possibility for so-called traditional student exchange. So students can go to the partner university also for full semester, but it's not used very much because then we have the online element anyway. So students can really be wherever in the world to complete the online study part. So then the virtual mobility, that's the key element. Since from the beginning of this, the whole program, the idea was to develop the skills of the teachers and students in online learning. And this is what something that I might be mixing. Like, we have always talked about online learning. Maybe the virtual mobility would be now the correct term here, or they can be combined. So from the beginning, we have continued after these after the physical mobility, these intensive programs, we have continued teaching and studying in Moodle online learning environment. When the teachers give their introductory lectures or seminars in the IPs, they also guide the students to the online work. We all use the same Moodle environment, makes life much easier. We only need to log into one system. So from the beginning, we have used Tampere University's Moodle. There are some courses or study units that are fully online. There's no online, no face-to-face introductory sessions. These are mainly like introduction courses to certain thematic areas. The teachers use various teaching and teaching methods on their courses. Of course, these more maybe traditional streamed or recorded lectures. There's weekly discussions, a lot of group work, peer reviews, learning diaries, some online exams, although they are they have not, there's maybe one or two. We rather use more interactive elements. Then essays still, this is also quite a traditional way, but there's always a combination, like it's never just recorded lectures and essay. There's always interactive elements on each of the courses. So conclusions from the program. Well, this this virtual mobility and online learning, it gives students a lot of freedom. And this was one of the points that we considered in the beginning when the program was planned, that we can like we can allow students to join the program who have a situation in their life that they would not been able to travel with the, like regular like full semester exchanges or even study in one university like with the regular lecture schedules. So we have had students working working or they have family, small children, and this gives them the possibility to schedule their studies more individually. Only the only compulsory face-to-face or on-site sessions are these IPs, which is 6 weeks in total. These are compulsory, but other than that, the studies are not tied to any specific place. So, for example, we've had master's thesis seminars where we have just a couple of students in class, and the rest of the students are in China, Canada, Austria. So this has worked really well. But then, of course, with this kind of freedom, there's also responsibility. And this is something that we stress to the students right from the beginning, that this is a full-time study program and we expect that the the studies are completed on time. And there's also responsibility to the fellow students because we use a lot of group work. So students must stick to their group's agreed schedules because, of course, it would affect everybody if there were students who didn't keep the schedules. We find the physical mobility still a very important element. It's maybe in this kind of full degree program, it's more important than in some shorter virtual study element. Clear that students are more committed when they know who they are working with. At least this has been also the feedback that we have received from the students, that they find it the first IP very important, so that they know who they are talking with when they start the virtual part of the program. But then, of course, there's also the problem that when in a regular program and in on-site program, the students, they are, of course, part of a larger student community, and our students are lacking this if they are not on campus. So we are... we have been trying to find solutions to this problem, and we have been offering some of the courses also to other student groups of our universities, so that our Kosovo students could then network with the larger student community, and this has been. Quite a nice development. Of course, they don't meet the face to face with these other students, but they have been able to work with them quite nicely, even if they don't know each other. don't seem to be able to upload the next slide. Maybe Fenna could help me with that. Okay, thank you. In this kind of program, students do need quite a lot of support and guidance in the beginning, especially if they are not very familiar with online learning, virtual studies. When we started over 10 years ago, this was clearly a problem, and we also had some problems with the language skills. Some students felt that in an online environment they couldn't keep up with some of the students who were more familiar with the online aspects and also the language skills. But this has improved a great deal. I mean, students today are much more ready for this kind of studies. In addition to these online discussion forums that we provide for the students, we do find that it is good to have regular local meetings with the students and staff. So we have meetings for the students and staff in Tampere and in Linz to discuss problems that students might have faced during the virtual part of the program. And in addition to students meeting together or with staff, it's really important also that the staff members meet regularly, both physically and virtually. So we have a meeting for the teachers during every IP. We also meet online. And this is... this has been important, and we have been able to do a great deal of knowledge exchange between the teachers during the program, and also we have been able to develop these virtual mobility periods and find new kinds of pedagogical solutions for the online teaching. This kind of sharing of information is really important, and since we find that this developing this kind of program, it's a continuous process. We cannot just simply stick to the solutions that we came up with a few years ago. There's all the time new solutions being developed, and we need to keep up with those. So it's also it's important that students keep or the teachers meet each other and discuss these ideas regularly. They also have access to their each other's courses so that they can see what kind of teaching methods that the others are using and what kind of contents they have, so that we avoid overlapping between the teachers. Well, finally, I could maybe say that we have often heard during the last 10 years or so that this kind of full degree program operating mostly online cannot be as good quality as a regular on-site taught program. And this is something that we have, we have done our best to show that a program based on these virtual elements is just as good as any other on-site program, that a virtual learning is not just recording lectures and placing them to some online platform. It's definitely much more, and it's demanding both for the teachers and for the students. And the feedback that we often receive from the students is that they actually find this kind of virtual program even more demanding than regular on-site programs. Of course, this current COVID-19 situation has brought us into a new situation as well, but we can adapt quite easily since we are already very much based on these virtual elements. Now we have had to change our next autumn's IP into a virtual IP. I'm sure that it will work out just fine, and we are also developing some new ways of supporting the students in their studies, such as virtual student tutoring and so forth. But that's all from me. Thank you very much. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer if you would like to contact me.
Thanks so much, Evelina. And indeed, also in your closing comments, like the online and virtual has proven to be as good quality as physical. I think it's an important message that you gave at the end. I want to thank, first of all the speakers of this morning session. We are now going to the questions. We very much realize that we have a bit of a delay, mainly because of some technical issues. I suggest you take your sandwiches with the screen now, because I think there are some important questions there, and I hope the speakers are also able to join us for another 15 to 20 minutes to go through some questions. Maybe not all, but there are some important ones there. So let me just check if I can put them on the screen. I pushed publish, but nothing happened. I don't know, maybe otherwise I'll just read the question. So just Fenna and Lizzie, I'm pushing the button publish, but I can't see them. One of the questions is, from your experience, does setting up a virtual mobility opportunities, there we are, between two international universities need a heavy load of coordination and communication? Looking at the examples that we have seen, it depends very much on the ambition and the complexity of your VM scheme. I can only say that on our virtual mobility website that has been linked in the chat, there are also templates which makes it easier to make bilateral agreements already. So these are templates for virtual mobility contracts, agreements between institutions. So that's already very much supporting your work. Then
maybe just to add, George, if you don't mind, mm-hmm. It is not a heavy load of coordination and commitment, but it is a heavy load of discussing and sharing different experiences and traditions of learning theories as well as learning design that is quite different from country to country, but also from different type of university. That is our experience when we had three universities from three countries, and one was a face-to-face, one was an online university, and one was blended learning.
Yeah, and for you, Christian, this question was also brought forward. What procedure do you follow to team up teachers?
Well, actually, the teachers were selected by the universities, and then we had always regular meetings, and we also insisted and we managed to have also face-to-face meetings at that time when COVID-19 was not yet there. But that was also very important to also get to a team spirit and to define the syllabus, and that was very helpful also in the repetition to improve the first course in the second round.
And another question for you, Christian, is this one.
I've done only, but okay. Yes, actually, all the students have done only the virtual mobility, as this was a closed course. But due to different requirements from the universities, in some universities the students had to follow up and to provide additional tasks. But the course was completely finished after the 8 weeks in the first round and the 6 weeks in the second round. And the feedback, as also presented in the slides, were only positive, in particular related to the chances, opportunities to work together with people from completely different cultures, not only related to the learning, but we had also students from New Zealand, from Latin America, from North America, from Africa, due to the fact that in the open and blended learning university, it's always the opportunity to start distance education from very far away.
Thanks. I think I'll take this question because it's about the what was discussed also in the introductory presentation. We see virtual mobility more as the overall term of different categories, different formats of mobility, and virtual exchange. I have two definitions for that. One is the one, the virtual version of the physical exchange, the classic physical exchange program, but then the virtual exchange, so the student taking a course individually at an, at another university. So there's the second format in our categorization. Virtual exchange is next to that, also used for an Erasmus program in which there is a more people-to-people dialogue on cultural issues. And then you can question if the term virtual exchange they're taken well different from how we normally would see it. So it is a bit confusing, but also literally that is virtual exchange because you have a dialogue between students. But virtual mobility we see as the overarching term for different forms of virtual mobility. Let me then go to another question. What are the best practices? From René. It's a bit difficult to find here. What questions? What are best practices? And how can we find other jointly to create? Yeah, well, the main question is how do you develop these programs, these virtual mobility programs, if you do not already know each other? Yeah, and from our experience, most initiatives are building on already colleagues from different universities that know each other. So that is actually mostly how it works. If not, if you do not know each other, I think you should follow these guidelines from our network curricula program, where you have different steps to solve problems, to face the challenges together. How you build a team. So within the NetQ guidelines, you can find guidelines to support your team, especially when you do not know each other that well. Then we go for questions for Tom. Let me check here. What are your experiences with SEPO and Houndspace? Do you see that question here somewhere? I'm a bit lost in the whole series of, here it is, publish. Is that something you can reply on, Tom? Oh, Tom needs to be in the presenters list. Give you some time to think about the question. Huh?
Any of those? I think this is a question for the person who presented before me. They've possibly mixed me up.
Oh, I'm not sure. Yeah. Well, I have another question for you then here. Didn't you have issues with security and confidentiality regarding the tools that you used?
No, because we discussed at the very start, we were helped by JISC, who run the joint academic networks in the UK. So they were very, very helpful to us in terms of how we would do our networking so that everything was very, very safe and secure. I think when you're trying to, you know, minimize latency, you obviously want to kind of get around firewalls, etc. So you have to be incredibly safe. It does take some convincing the campus network people, but having people like JISC or GIANT in European countries or GAR in Italy, who have been fantastic in terms of providing guidelines for safe networking protocols so that you don't, you're not jeopardizing the security of the university network.
And I think a question that many ask themselves, how did you convince your university to invest in this?
Oh, that's a tough question. It's ongoing. At the start, we didn't know what we were doing, so it was difficult to convince them about anything. But again, I think that was mostly our fault for being semi-inarticulate about what we wanted to achieve. I mean, to be honest, the big thing that helped us, we won a Reimagine Education Award, which all of a sudden made people take us seriously, at least momentarily. I mean, obviously, this is, you know, we lucked out by winning an award, but I think that kind of badge of success enabled. But even then, it was a struggle to get funding for the equipment. We were renting the equipment, and somebody early on asked a question about the equipment. We managed to buy the equipment when I managed to convince management that it was actually costing us £4,000 a year more to hire the equipment than it was to actually buy the equipment. And of course, when we hired the equipment, we only had it for a few weeks. Now that we bought the equipment, we have the equipment year round and other people can use that equipment as well for their own projects. As yet, no one has, but I know of some courses which are thinking of adapting the equipment, adapting the setup for their own purposes. So eventually it pays for itself. And then if you also take in environmental concerns and the expense it would take for me to take 20 students to Finland or Poland for a two-week course and to, you know, to pay for that, it brings it out of the range of a lot of students. So the joy of this system is we get, you know, we get a two-week course, which is international, in which we can do virtually everything except touch. But, you know, in the era of social distancing, I think this is going to be widespread. But eventually, yeah, it has started to pay for itself. So the investment in the equipment has started to pay for itself. And I think the university, I think post-COVID-19, are really starting to see the value of stuff like this in terms of international collaboration.
Thanks so much, Tom. Then I have some questions for Nadja. Were the ECTS acquired during the VM recognized, reflected in the diploma supplement?
Sorry, I didn't hear the... Yeah. Can you were put it
ECTS,
there?
Were ECTS acquired during VM recognized, reflected in the diploma supplement?
And we have had, until now, our mobilities mainly with Latin America. So there's not the European diploma supplement there.
And also, if a student studies at home university, majority of the courses at home university, and attend only 6 to 12 ECTS abroad on VM, what is then the status of the student? Is that, oh yeah, here's a question.
This is very technical questions, but this is something that when we negotiate the MOU, we try to agree on all these different issues. So once the MOU is signed, all this is solved, and it depends very much on the different institutions.
And a final question for you, Nadja. Is there an average time in WOX experience from the MOU to students starting to take the course?
This I already tried to answer in the chat before. So we have two semester starts in September and February. So if we want to start the mobility in September, we have to have everything organized by July. And it normally takes us between 2 to 3 months, but we can now do it also a bit quicker. So it depends. If there are no big institutional obstacles, we can set it up quite fast.
Okay, thanks, Nadja. Let me check for other questions.
Yeah, I think there was the other question on language, right? This is also related to the first one. So our campus now is in both Catalan and Spanish. So our main experiences have been what I said before with universities from different Latin American countries. But we're also working on having more offers in English or seeing whether it could be interesting for institutions where students are studying Spanish or Catalan to come to our institution and then also get more proficient in the language.
Yeah, thanks. Just asking, Fena, do you see some questions specifically for Evelina? There are some, I think here, here's an important question. I'm going to publish this one. I can't do that, I see. Is there any kind of online forum for exchanging information about possibilities of VM? Or, more importantly, to look for international partners and organize joint projects, for example, a VM project similar to TAMP? To my knowledge, there's only one initiative in that, and that is within the OpenVM project. Let me check. So there is a hub from OpenVM where you can find these calls for partners also. There is a also special interest group in which we bring together interested or active experts in virtual mobility and in continuing the innovations in virtual mobility. This will be further highlighted tomorrow. So this was a good question and will be further highlighted tomorrow. Maybe the question, if we, I can already tell you that some institutions are not yet ready for VM. It's a question by Ian. In my institution, can you display that one? I can already tell you that some institutions are not yet ready for the VM. My institution, only engineering, the studies department was challenged by how organizing the online assessment during COVID crisis teaches. We're not all ready to be able, yeah. Indeed, it asks for some digital expertise also, but you also gain that in the partnership. I think maybe the first step to do so, if you are interested in virtual mobility, is connect with universities that already are experienced in that sense. That would make you immediately part of a network of universities in which you can participate. And I think the best vehicle for that is certainly also the European University Alliances. These are already well connected, and certainly some of the universities have already this expertise or could get the expertise from the hub, the Bloom Hub, or from the EADTU Virtual Mobility website, in which we also share the expertise from our experts. So there's always an opportunity to contact us and ask for expertise exchange or people to support you in there.
Can I add something to that, George? That what we have seen now, no, and as I explained before, in our case, we have this experience of 25 years of offering completely online education. So the change wasn't really so deep now during the COVID situation. And what we tried to offer, because we knew that many universities had to pass from one day to another to some remote teaching, we offered a lot of webinars and all of that to get like the basic ideas. But we tried to differentiate between what is online learning, no, as the way we do it normally, and where you need a lot of time for setting up everything, and what many are experiencing now, which is more emergency remote teaching, probably, no. So if you do this, obviously there might be many difficulties also in relationship with online exams and all of that. But in our case, we also moved, because this was one of the elements we still did face to face. So we moved to online exams. We had 30,000 the last week, and it worked very well. So I think it really depends on how you prepare, and hopefully we can all, with more time, get into this. But it's quite different from like what you do in an emergency and what you can then do with more time in the future.
Thanks, Nadja. And indeed, there is a lot of expertise. And within EADTU, we have an inventory of a list of experts in this field. So please contact us if you are in need of this expertise in virtual mobility under the different categories. That is always possible. I think this covers most of the questions. Also, for everyone, if there is a final question, please let me know. I see already most have to leave as we are already ahead of time. Well, that leads me then to thanking all the presenters from today. Thanks again for sharing your examples and good practices under the four categories. And if you as attendee have examples that fit these categories, please let us know, and we can include them in our descriptions on our virtual mobility website, which I displayed again the link in the chat. And I hope also to see you tomorrow at the multiplier event from OpenVM, which is starting at the same time, 10:15 till 12:30. And you will have the link when you have registered to Eventbrite. So thanks again for the attendees for joining today, and also for the speakers for your contributions. Hope to see you tomorrow.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Goodbye.